Hello, everyone. I'm the Director of Career Services, Twyla Hupp. I see some familiar faces. Thank you all for coming out. I'm excited that you all are here to talk with our guests and our student host today, hopefully to have a conversation. There are some key questions that he'll go through, but then he'll also allow some flexibility. So I'm gonna let him do his thing in a few moments. I just wanted to make a few housekeeping announcements. The Department of Philosophy is co-sponsoring this event. There is a philosophy department student handbook. If you do not have one, please be sure to get one before you leave. In addition to that, we have some upcoming programs that might also be of interest to you in addition to this. One of the ones that I think would probably be of interest is the gap year panel that will be coming up on the 24th. And then in addition to that, that's on the 24th at 12:30 in the Coastal University Center of Waxahachie. Any of you interested in something like AmeriCorps? Who else is coming? Who else is coming for the gap year panel?
We've got AmeriCorps, another AmeriCorps program, the NCCC, the National Student Corps. And then we've got the TU advising for City Year and the Casa de Esperanza House of Cool.
Mm-hmm. So how many of you are seniors? Okay, well, if you have senior friends, tell them.
I mean, whose application window takes a while, so it's actually better if you're not a senior if you're in the Peace Corps.
And if you're thinking about possibly taking a gap year before you go into whatever's next, that'll be a good program. Katie Ramirez is the one who's checking you all in. She is the advisor to students who major in philosophy and several other majors. She's the one who helped to become the impetus. She was the impetus for this in collaboration with the Department of Philosophy. Another panel that might be of interest to you all is the Humanities program that's happening on March 31st. That one's gonna involve 10 to 12 alumni who have various backgrounds in academic areas, including philosophy, religion, English, communication, and so forth. And so if you wanna talk to some other people about their career pathways, that's definitely a program to check out. Katie's business cards are up here. If you're trying to figure out what to do with your life, if you're trying to figure out what sort of jobs you might pursue, she's a good person for you to meet with. You probably want to do it soon. You may have noticed that she's probably going to be going on leave, and so you probably want to try and get with her as soon as you can. When she leaves, though, rest assured, I will be taking over for her areas to make sure that you all are getting continuous support. So please make sure you do that, and then... Oh, course offerings. There's also a handout up front with course offerings. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to our student host.
Hi, everybody. My name is Daniel Conrad. If you don't know me, I am a junior philosophy major. I'm also the president of our philosophy club, and I'm really excited to be hosting this panel. And want to have the opportunity for everyone to introduce themselves. So if you will, just state your name and who you work for and in what capacity.
Sure. My name is Mason Stark, and I work for the Rivard Report, which is an online news site, and I work on the business side. My official title is Membership Coordinator. We'll talk more about that.
My name is Sean Caporaletti. I'm a senior manager at Trinity Mineral Management. We are a mineral management company representing land and royalty owners. Who have oil and gas production. Most of our clients are in South Texas. I come from I'm an attorney, and originally worked for the man, for big oil, and then saw a real need for landowner representation, so that's what brought me to Trinity Mineral Management.
Okay. I'm Austen Hall, and I work with AmeriCorps Public Allies, which is a federal program for volunteerism. So I'm doing a 10-month period of service, which ends in July. And I'm working here at Trinity University, so I'm in the Office of Experiential Learning with volunteerism and community service initiatives. So a big part of my role is serving as a staff advisor to TUVAC.
Cool. Hi, I'm Eliza Grady. I work on Ron Nirenberg's campaign. He's running for mayor of San Antonio, and I'm the regional field director, which means that I assist and oversee a lot of our field work, which is basically canvassing and phone making.
Thank you all. So I'm going to ask some questions and then open it up for questions and answers from all of you. And then whenever the panel is over, feel free to stick around and maybe like informally network if you think that something's interesting to you. But to begin with the panelist questions. What I'll do is ask the question, and if you want to, you know, feel free to kind of like volunteer yourself to answer the question, or if you think that you have something interesting to add, feel free to jump in. If somebody could answer, maybe how did your philosophy experience here at Trinity? How did that maybe guide you to where you are now? How do you kind of integrate it?
Okay, so when I first started my philosophy major, I took a lot of ethics and political philosophy, and at the time I was also pairing that with a lot of poli-sci classes, and what was really cool about that was I had like one foot in political theory and then one foot in political execution, and that really opened a door to my interest in politics, and it really inspired me to learn how, you know, when someone says they believe a certain value or they want to bring this to a certain city, district, or nation, learning, taking my analytical skills from philosophy and actually analyzing how they do that through their own practice, and that brought me into like political internships, and now I'm on the political.
I followed a similar path out of Trinity. My first job was working for a U.S. congressman, and I started as a political science major, and I took Intro to Philosophy with Dr. Norman, and then I took another one, Before I knew it, I had the minor completed, and then I had time to make it a double major, so I did that, but what was the question?
Do you see what the skills that you kind of gained through the philosophy courses?
Yes.
Do you see yourself putting those into practice?
Right. So, leading into law school, if y'all have had a relative, for me it was my grandfather who told me what $1.50 in a philosophy degree would get you. It is what you do with it. So, working for a congressman, I use the word perspective a lot. You gain perspective as to how different people approach their situations. And so having the philosophy classes and the major, you really get an opportunity to see different sides of the situation, looking at people, their ideas from their perspective rather than, in some other courses you have a 101 class, and this is accounting is done, how it's been done, and how you're going to do it when you're a CPA. Philosophy, you all know that it's a much more well-rounded, open discussion sort of environment, and I think that helps tremendously.
Touching on that and touching on the question of skills transferring over, I think that a liberal arts education in general aims at this, but I think, and obviously I'm a little biased, but I think philosophy does it best in teaching you to communicate clearly and also to think carefully. So in any role that you go into, and I've noticed it in my position here, that's not always something that people have training in. So just communicating over a simple issue can take a lot longer or be more complicated than it needs to be because people haven't had that training in kind of paring down, okay, what's the essential thing that we're talking about here and how do I communicate that to somebody else? So I've definitely seen that in my role as kind of like a payoff of my philosophical education.
Going off of that, I think something interesting, like from the female perspective, is that type of communication. I think in the classroom, we're really taught to disagree with each other, and that's something I've actually been asked a lot, is are you confident and comfortable disagreeing with people? And honestly, I think because of philosophy, I've been desensitized to it, and so yes, I am. I am very comfortable disagreeing, and I'm much more confident and comfortable stating my opinion in the workplace. And I've noticed that even some women who are higher up than me don't have that confidence in that practice.
That makes sense.
Yeah. I think speaking to the point of philosophy being a skill-building pursuit, I think the points about it developing concise writing, developing the ability to communicate an argument or a viewpoint succinctly and clearly. I think those are the two most valuable skills I've experienced so far, or that I've recognized so far. I work in fundraising. That's what membership coordinator means. It's a nonprofit news site, And so my job is to convince people to pay for local journalism, which is, I mean, if you work for any nonprofit, it's, you're basically a salesman or a saleswoman. And sales is hard enough. It's harder whenever it's, you're not receiving something directly in return. It's like all of our content is free, so I need to convince people to pay for something they're already receiving. And marketing, I think experience in marketing helps, but philosophy helps as well, because I'm able to identify, the sorts of values people might care about, and how those overlap with a regular news reader. I'm starting to ramble.
Awesome.
Well, I don't want to belabor this question too much if you want to move on, but I also think one last skill that I've noticed that not everybody has, that I notice in people who have been trained in philosophy, is the ability to like entertain an idea or a position without being committed to it, which really helps in the workplace when you're talking about different solutions to a problem. Sometimes people will propose a solution, and because it's their solution, they don't look at the other side of it. But I think philosophy kind of like forces you, it desensitizes you, it makes you be able to entertain a position and look at the other side of it as well, which is really useful in group conversations.
Awesome. So when we're taking courses, when we're in university, we're, in the back of our minds is, what am I going to do with all of this knowledge? What am I going to do once I graduated? And each of you have kind of gone in a different direction, whether it's politics, law, volunteer coordination, the business side of journalism. Was there a particular moment, or maybe a class, or an experience that you had in studying philosophy that perhaps was kind of a, or at least contributed to, a eureka moment, where it was like, this is something I feel passionate about, or this is something that I can put into practice? Or that I can see myself kind of embodying. Was there any moment like that for any of you?
I would need to think more about a specific example, but kind of a theme I identified with my college experience at Trinity, and this is not only in studying philosophy, it's liberal arts in general, is that in contrast to the highly specialized fields you can major in, engineering or computer science, I think those are highly valued, right? And liberal arts is sometimes disparaged for not being specialized, but I think it is specializing in something, and that's kind of being a well-rounded, thoughtful citizen. And I think that's what sort of turned me on to philosophy. It was not a means to an end. It wasn't something I was pursuing to get X job. I was pursuing philosophy because I guess it is a means to an end, right? To become a better person. but it also is an end in itself, I think, because I value the pursuit of knowledge in itself. And through studying philosophy, I realized that. But tying it back into my career that I have now, all of a sudden, I think I was drawn to the Rivard Report because it's a news agency that is aiming at providing people in San Antonio the information they need to be informed, involved, good citizens. So seeing that connection between the two is what made me make that jump. Also, they offered to pay me to do things. First time that happened.
So I always thought that I wanted to be an attorney, especially even when I was at Trinity, and I took symbolic logic. And I was told at the beginning of the class, people that do well in this class typically go on to become attorneys. I did not do well in that class. Not at all. If y'all have taken it, you start somewhere and it builds and builds and builds and builds. Well, I fell off about halfway through and I never caught back up. But it really was useful in the in what I do. I look at leases and contracts every single day, and the language is, if this, then that, if not that, then this, but if this, then that. So I remember that much. So it helped. It definitely helps. And it's just the way of thinking. Being, you mentioned liberal arts, being able to be a well-rounded person, and through philosophy you can, I keep using perspective, you're able to associate and affiliate with people of all walks of life. So in my business, it's with executives and ranchers. It's with English speakers and non-English speakers. It's from all different walks of life that have different views, liberal and conservative. And so being able to associate with all of them is extremely important in my job.
I had a similar experience with the major. So I took Intro to Philosophy my freshman year, and I felt very at home in this type of classroom. Like, it just kind of fit with how I naturally thought. And I do agree, like, I think it gives you this foundation which you constantly have to communicate with different types of people. Like, I feel like, you know, when you're in high school, you take Latin to learn the roots of words you do well on the SAT. I feel like philosophy, in a way, gives you, like, the root of ideas, and so that whenever you go out and you see a position or a person you don't know, you have this root reference in a way that allows you to adapt to the situation. And I guess relating to my profession, I have to do canvassing all the time, which means I'm literally going out in San Antonio, knocking on someone's door, and I'm trying to convince them to vote for a specific person. And just that experience has shown me there's not like one face to a city, there's not like one standard of living or one lifestyle, and the ability to communicate and also more quickly understand people is so helpful. And I think that's what you really get with a philosophy education here.
Could you repeat the question a little bit? That's kind of obnoxious. I don't know if my answer can fit exactly with that, because I think I'm the... All right. So I'm going to grad school. So I'm like on the more traditional path, I guess. So I'm more of like a gap year than a... This is my career. But I can talk about something that kind of was in sort of what Mason was saying, is that I think it's really important to study what you're interested in, like intrinsically. So for me, that was philosophy. I had similar experiences to other people were saying on this panel, right? I sat in a philosophy class and I was like, oh, this is what gets me excited. Like, it's not, oh, I have to go to this class and I have to read these books that I don't like. It's like, okay, I'm excited for class. And for me, that's what helped me figure out what I want to do long term. But even if that's not how it ends up, you're studying something that you really enjoy, so you're gonna have a better time in college. And you're picking up these communication skills, these critical thinking skills that will serve you well with whatever else you end up doing. So that's kind of my take on this.
Speaking for Austen, I can identify his spark moment. it was a morning in October. I've known Austen since our first year of college, and I think his roommate Dominic was kind of. I remember one morning he walked up to me and he had, you know, two 20-ounce cans of Red Bull, and his eyes were bloodshot, and, you know, I was like, it's not even finals week, what's going on? And he said, oh, me and Dominic were up until 4 o'clock in the morning talking about something that we had learned in a philosophy class. And I was not a philosophy major at that point, but seeing those two have so much passion for the subject, I mean, not directing their efforts toward any assignment, project, just doing it for the sake of doing it. I think, am I going to cry? I think just doing it for the sake of doing it. That was his spark, and then it kind of sparked my spark, and I hope some of y'all are sparking.
And spark each other.
That's great.
So I can share my eureka moment. I shared my deflating moment and my failure in symbolic logic, but taking biomedical ethics, having those conversations, and those are tough conversations to have, and people are very, very opinionated, and they stand very strong on their convictions on that. But being able to take that class, and the reading was very informative, and really forced us to have those tough discussions. At that point is when I realized that I could actually pursue a career in law. And appreciate the different stances, being able to argue different stances. So that taking that class was a real confidence builder in my feeling of being able to do that as a profession.
So this will be my last question for y'all before opening it up to Q&A. Here's, I guess, an opportunity to provide any advice for students in attendance or watching. If you have any advice about kind of what it's like to take the leap from graduating and then finding a way to apply your degree, what is that like? What would you advise students to maybe start doing now, maybe look forward to being able to do?
I could take a stab at it. Kind of going back to what I was saying earlier, I think that there's some anxiety, or at least I had some anxiety. I don't know if this is widespread, but feeling like you have to go into something that is specifically related to your major, because that's not the case. So I feel like there's some anxiety, like, oh, I need to find a job that my philosophy degree is tailored to specifically. But I don't think that's necessarily the way that you should be thinking about it. And going back to what I was saying earlier about following something that you're interested in, so if while you're in school you're interested in philosophy, study philosophy, and then when you're looking for something to do afterwards, don't feel constrained by what your major was, right? Like, look and see what you're interested in out there in terms of careers, in terms of volunteerism, and all the training that you received as part of your philosophy degree will just naturally come with you and will naturally follow, and you'll just naturally begin to apply those skills in whatever field you end up in.
Something that helps me sleep at night is that I've frequently read our generation, we are not going to enter the workforce and stay in that one particular industry for the rest of our lives. That's just not going to happen. I think it's estimated we're going to have about 5 different careers in our lifetime. And so that alleviated a lot of stress for me. And then also, I've also read it's not your major, but your internship and work experience that will actually prepare you for the workforce. And I was fortunate in a way that I was very close with people at Trinity who are 2 years older than me. And I saw the path of people who had 0 internships during college, and I saw where they ended up, and I did not want to be there. And so I just, summer of my junior to senior year, and since then I've been working internships every 3 months during school and whatnot. And what I learned from that is, philosophy is this foundation, and I identified the career I wanted to go into based off my interests that had nothing to do with my major. And through evaluating the skills I learned in my major, I learned how to market myself for that a career in those interests. It wasn't based upon my major. And so I think it is a little difficult because it's like you're balancing multiple plates at once, but I think it's important to be aware of the multiple faucets of your interest and your personality, and know it's not just determined by your major, and there are other things you can do to make yourself an attractive employee.
You're not just a philosophy major.
Yeah. You're complicated.
Yeah. Yeah, building on Eliza's point, I would agree that you shouldn't box yourself into a major. You have to declare a major for the sake of your academic program, but it doesn't define you as a person. Mm-hmm. Do an internship. They aren't going to care if you're a philosophy major or a computer science major or whatever, unless you're wanting a computer science internship, in which case you'd have to really argue your case. People are looking for free labor, and it's the perfect opportunity for you all to provide that. So go out and try and find an internship in something you're interested in, and I think that can be the hardest part is figuring out what you're interested in beyond your studies. That it was for me. I'm available to talk about that. We can brainstorm. I think Eliza's right to say that you should, if you want to major in philosophy and you want a career afterwards, not in academia, you should definitely find some internships while in college. Otherwise, you'll be doing internships after you graduate.
And career services is great at helping you find internships.
It is, yeah. Great resources.
Absolutely. Yeah, utilize your career services, whatever options you have, because when you're thrown into the real world and have no one or nowhere to go, you're going to wish that you had those internships and those experiences while you were a student, while you didn't have bills, responsibilities, student loans, things like that. You're not going to find a lot of job postings that say qualifications of BA in philosophy. You will some places, but in business,
they're going to want a business, finance, accounting, and you can imagine all the different postings that you might see out there, but don't let that limit you. You have to use it as a selling point to show that you're a well-rounded person, you're a thinker. You can solve the problems that they have, that your potential employer may have in whatever industry they're in, because you have rewired your brain to think however you need to think to get a job done. So it's a challenge, but it's not because you're a philosophy major, it's because the world that we live in doesn't recognize or appreciate what it is that the education that we received as philosophy majors.
That might be changing.
Creative thinking skill of the future.
Right. I do want to say that we've framed this discussion a lot in terms of being a philosophy major, but I think that that's kind of constraining as well. So if you're interested in taking philosophy classes, but you don't want to be a philosophy major or a minor, that's fine too. I think that there's some anxiety with Trinity students. I know I felt it too, where like every class you take needs to be going to a major or a minor or a certificate or something like that. That's definitely not the case. You have to have at least one major. And besides that, feel free to explore with other classes. You don't have to be a philosophy major to benefit from philosophical training. So I do want to make that point. And then I want to say, speaking a little bit to my own experience more than just generalities, if you really don't know at all what you want to do, doing a term of service is great. And so it's kind of a shameless plug for the gap year panel. But that was kind of my experience. I really didn't know. I knew I wanted to take a gap year. I knew I wanted to eventually go on to study at the graduate level. But I didn't know. And I knew I wanted to do something that was meaningful to me. So these programs give you the opportunity to do all of that. And they also help with professional development and plugging you into different fields that you might be interested in. So for me, it was school, but a lot of my fellow people doing this term of service are getting plugged into different careers, and they're networking during their time doing this term of service. So it's a really rewarding and intrinsically valuable experience that can then kind of be the touching off point for your later career.
Thank you. So I want to open our panelists up for questions from the audience. Any question for a particular panelist or something that you want to ask everybody, raise your hand on and be ready. I actually have one of my own. So this is for Austen. Much of what we talked about is about applying your philosophical studies and the skills that you get from that into the workplace, but you applied for graduate school.
I did.
What is that like, and do you have any advice for students who are maybe considering going down that route?
That's a good question.
Can you start now? Or
yeah, I'm not going to lie, it's a rough process. But yeah, I would start early. And with anything, I think talk to your professors, like develop relationships with your professors, because it's a tough process, and you feel like you don't really have any bearings when you start off. So. Talk to your professors, you know, ask them, you know, here's what I'm interested in, or I'm thinking about going to grad school, what schools might be good for me, or what should I start looking at kind of as part of that process. And then those professors will also, we have a great faculty in terms of giving their time and their energy to helping you out. So if you start that process early with communicating with your faculty, they can be with you through that entire process. I mean, I had multiple of the professors helping me out with my writing sample, like until the day that I was sending off my applications. But it is a daunting task, but I would say definitely start early if you're thinking about doing that, and rely on your support system, so your faculty, your family, your friends. Do you have more specific questions about the process?
Not in particular, no. But that's probably because I don't know all that much about the process itself. So could you maybe talk about that?
In terms of like
writing sample, for instance.
Right, okay. So yeah, most of the applications are going to require a resume, a personal statement, letters of recommendation and a writing sample. And then depending on the application, they have different like short essay questions or something like that. That's kind of like the basic package. And most of the applications open in around September and then close like late December through mid-January. So that's kind of like the timeline that you're looking at. So if you're wanting to start grad school immediately after you graduate, you need to be looking at that like the summer before your senior year, like start that process. There's actually, I think philosophy is kind of lucky in that we have a resource that a lot of other fields don't, and that there's something called the Philosophical Gourmet Report, which it's a kind of a ranking of schools. It's compiled by professionals in the discipline, so they try to avoid bias that way. But if you just look up Philosophical Gourmet Report, it kind of like lists out schools that are strong in different areas and how they're regarded by people in the profession. So that's a great starting point as well, that kind of like a compiled listing that I think a lot of other disciplines, like my friends who are applying in like anthropology and stuff, don't have a resource like that. So professors, Philosophical Gourmet, that's the place to start, and that's the timeline.
Thanks.
Just another plug. Career Services is also doing a lunch and learn for graduate school application process. So for those of you who want some questions about the details of when to start, what that timeline looks like, how to identify ones that fit for you, it's on that lunch and learn flyer, and it's going to be on March 24th at 12:30.
I do want to say, so I mentioned professors as a resource, but also Career Services. So Katie helped me every step of the way also from the very beginning when I was just looking at like, oh, maybe I'll apply to this school. Help me with my resume, everything, my personal statement. So, yeah, Career Services, talk to them as well.
Any other questions?
So I know philosophy is often paired with like a lot of other disciplines. Like I know Sean mentioned you got a double major and stuff, and other degrees, not necessarily majors, or like other classes. Do you think philosophy helped bring out more in those classes, and maybe how that helped your career, whether you got like minors or another major or something? Because like, that's something I'm looking at to like supplement or enhance the philosophy.
Yeah, I took a minor called Arts, Letters, and Enterprise, which is about as like obscure sounding as membership coordinator. It's organized by Dr. Tingle and the Experiential Learning Office, and it's tailored for people like me who majored in one of the humanities or natural sciences, but don't necessarily want to go to grad school. So they want to work on some skills as they apply directly to the business world. So if that's you, you might consider it. Probably the most valuable experience I had with that program was an internship I did with a local nonprofit consulting firm. And that kind of led to my further interest in nonprofits in San Antonio. So I recommend, at the very least, doing an internship.
What are you thinking of double majoring in?
Oh, looking at computer science of all things, actually. Like, I know they don't complement each other.
Oh, they totally do.
Oh, they do.
I just think of it.
Yeah.
I
basically just take some ball of logic twice. So.
You should talk to John Croxton. I think he's a philosophy computer science double major that's a junior.
Yeah.
When he gets back from France.
I took CS1, so it's like I can't.
Yeah.
Talk a lot about it, but I will say that the way you think about things, deconstructing arguments into their little logical bits and pieces, is valuable for thinking about computer science, at least in CS1 it was.
I have that same experience, so I vouch for that too.
Yeah, I just think, if you're saying that like your majors or industries, whatever, are like building, I feel like philosophy is always like it's the concrete base. And I think a reason maybe our majors don't respect is you don't see the concrete base of a lot of buildings, right? You just see the architecture and whatnot. Because I know I took a Shakespeare class, and there are a lot of philosophical arguments and whatnot I saw in Shakespeare, obviously, that made it a lot easier to get through that whole semester. But I think identifying, I like to use like the major and minor as like, this is more concrete area of interest I have. So I really like taking political science classes. And so kind of learning like what you like to do and how to pair, you know, maybe these misunderstood skills with philosophy with these like very concrete skills that are more digestible, that's what I would suggest.
I'm just gonna co-sign on what I say. From the employer's perspective, employers value someone who has that computer science, finance, engineering degree, and then also have something that allows them to approach problems from a different way, because that means you're going to approach problems different from every other kind of cookie cutter person who had a degree that was exclusively computer science. And those people who approach problems more broadly like that, which you get from a philosophy degree, or courses in philosophy, those are the individuals who also progress in that organization or in the field much quicker because of their ability to quickly adapt and observe different things that other people wouldn't have knowledge
of. From a professional standpoint, it doesn't really matter what you pair with your philosophy minor or major. I think just pairing it with something will make you more marketable in the professional environment, in the real world. It's, to me, that's kind of a shame, because there's some very smart, well-rounded people who are solely philosophy majors or solely poli-sci majors, but it's just not the best sales pitch to have. So if you do have that paired with something, I think it makes you even more marketable to have the foundation with some other skill set. It doesn't matter what it is, it's just something.
Any other questions?
Well, I still have a follow-up on that one, which is, how important is it that kind of peer, which is maybe for Tyler as well as panel, is explicitly in a, so sometimes I have students ask me, well, but do I have to get the minor in political science, or is just taking a few classes in political science enough to tell that story about how I have both things? I mean, do employers actually look at your transcript, or do they just listen to what you tell them?
Yeah.
Why don't law school admissions look at your transcript? That's for sure. So, like I said earlier, I mean, I took one class, and then I took another one, and I just fell in love with it. And I think that's the great thing about having a liberal arts education, is that, you know, you're not getting into a program that just teaches you how to be one thing and you're pigeonholed into that. Especially in a world that we live in, where we may have two or three or four different careers in our lifetime. If you're in one program that only gives you one skill set, it might actually hurt you in the long run if you find yourself in a, you know, if oil drops from $100 to $25 a barrel. If you're only an oil guy, then you might have to find a job somewhere else. But if you have that well-rounded education and an open-minded approach, then you can, you know, you can accommodate, you can evolve with changing industries. So your question was whether you take one or two classes or a minor, whatever you're comfortable with, I think is. The right answer, I don't know.
I don't have the employer's perspective, so I can't say with a lot of authority, but my line has been, and I'll stick to it, like, I think getting into these conversations, sometimes there can be a lot of anxiety, right? Like, I need a double major, and so I can't take any other classes besides this thing that I've elected to be my double major. So I would say definitely don't choose a double major, don't choose a major or a minor to pair with your philosophy major just because you want to be a double major, right? Because you're going to be slogging through upper division classes that you don't like, and you're going to be limiting your ability to take classes in fields that you might have enjoyed more. So there are benefits to having a double major, there are benefits to having a minor, but if possible, let it happen organically. Right? So just take classes that you're interested in. You might find yourself in the minor rather than constraining your education to fit that mold that you've made for yourself.
And it doesn't have to be in your education section just to be on your resume or as a minor or a major. I had a student who was an English major, econ minor yesterday, and she wants to go into a field that may involve accounting, which was her previous major. And so she said, should I try to double major? I'm like, no, you're a junior in your second semester. No, please don't. But she can put on her resume 12 hours completed in accounting. Or if she took some computer classes but didn't get the major or a minor, she can put 15 hours completed in computer science. The other thing is what they said earlier, internships. sometimes they're more interested in what you did in your internship than what you say as far as a minor or a, you know, something along those lines. Be creative.
I agree with that. I think if you're a philosophy major and say you're interested in political science and you're thinking about doing a minor or a double major, like Austen said, take the classes that you're most interested in and then try and then call Eliza and say, hey, can I come campaign with Ron Nirenberg or whoever?
We are looking.
Yeah, that was not a political endorsement. I think Twyla is right to say that I think employers are more interested in, and it makes you stand out more if you can point to a real world experience that you paired with your traditional academic education. Don't box yourself into saying I have to major in political science because that's what I'm interested in. Take classes you're really interested in, and same goes for philosophy. Take the classes you're really interested in and skip the ones that you don't think are as important to you. And try and tailor your image that way if your goal is getting a job right out of college.
Any other questions? Okay. It's 1:15, so if anybody would like to come up and grab one of the student handbooks, the calendars, or the course catalog for next semester, feel free to do so. Also, our panelists are obligated in a sense to be here till 1:30, so they're going to be around, and feel free to talk about, you know, what they do or anything you wanted to ask in private. Thank you all for coming. We really appreciate it. And let's give a hand to our panelists.